Hey, welcome to episode 79 of The 6-Inch Show. My name is Fly Guy from flyguy.net, and I found this guy in the street called Matt, and he's going to join me. So, how are you doing?
Yeah, doing good.
Got your troopers for display this evening. Remnants everywhere.
Remnants everywhere, and the good old Lucasfilm 50 bucks.
Nice. Yes, that was very nice, Hasbro. Yeah. Thank you, Hasbro. So we are the 6-Inch Show, and what we're here to cover is Hasbro predominantly, Marvel Legends, Star Wars The Black Series, G.I. Joe, and we pretty much get everything for you tonight. A little tiny little smattering of reveals and some other bits and pieces, stuff you can buy right now or you can't buy because it's sold out, but we'll cover all that for you coming up soon. So let's dive in first of all and look at the comments we had from the last show, episode 78, and some of the comments you guys had, because some of them were pretty interesting. Some good questions. We did ask you the last time if you wanted to try and get some answers to some questions about toys, about the cost of toys and distribution and so forth, and a kind of x-ray into the insights of Hasbro and distribution, just a little bit more to explain what goes on in the background, because we have a little bit of knowledge and we can hopefully pass that on. Really interesting questions though, people asked. Let us share that on screen and you can see it, and I'll blow it up a little bit so hopefully people can see it a little better. Can you see that okay? You sharing the screen clear enough?
Yeah, I can see it.
Cool, cool. Hopefully if you're watching Peeps, you can see it too. Michael Bell commented on the show. He was enjoying it. He really liked the photographs and was saying that toy photography really helps him in decisions and buying the figures. So there you go. Hasbro, get more of your toys sent out to people so we can get some photographs. Joe P was asking about a George Lucas figure, if we could recommend that the next time we speak to Hasbro. They kind of do take it on, and they don't, but there's heavy, heavy rumors about I think it's that said there somewhere. Yes, there's already heavy, heavy rumors about a George Lucas figure coming, but time will tell. We'll see what happens with that, whether they eventually do it or not. Nathan Dean was enjoying the show. He was saying thanks about the stands. Yes, if you're into stands, the link in the description of just about every video. And they're really good for Star Wars Black Series and Marvel Legends. That they work for me. Let us know what you think of them. A good old chappy that we know very well, The Force Is With Jesse, who does his own show as well. Definitely check him out, The Force Is With Jesse. He's enjoyed the last couple of shows and liked the questions that we put forward. Thank you, dude. Kuldip Bining, who was asking why some of us weren't kind of represented on some of the actual FanFest kind of wall panel, which I kind of felt, do you remember that when they did that and they had all these fan channels up in the background, but they only let one speak?
The Shardimus talk.
Yeah, but I felt kind of like, why did they invite them all if they're not going to even let them get a word in? But very strange, very, very strange.
Yeah.
Why bother? Anyway, Christopher Miller was talking about Mafex, and he's seen quality control on Mafex has dipped a little. Let us know what you think, but I don't know. Have you noticed any?
Yeah, Mafex is well, I don't know if Mafex, I don't know, I was about to say Mafex, but I mean, to me, SH Figure Arts has dropped the ball on their stuff of late. And for me, Mafex has kind of gone up in the world of DC and all that other stuff. But by no means does that mean they've gone up on everything. It's just I like the DC stuff. I think it looks great. Haven't seen too many many complaints about breakages as there used to be with the DC figures. And there's a lot of the Batmans out there. But look, I don't know. I think that... you know, I'm not starting a war because I think people have admitted SH Figure Arts has dropped the ball in the last year compared to where they were.
I know.
And Mafex, I think it's getting better, but they're maybe dropping it in other things.
Mm. So he was looking at the IG-11's ankles and the arm rotation. And yeah, look, it's a very thinly designed figure anyway. So yeah, you're probably going to have problems. Kenneth Creeley Jr., we salute you, sir. Yet another comment there from him and all the stuff he's interested in. Kenny, you're interested in everything, sir. So there's no one thing that dude is not buying, but good on you for keeping the economy going and the YouTube economy too. He was really enjoying, he's always a big DC fan. He was enjoying Jack Snyder's Justice League, Marvel's select version of Scarlet Witch. He's talking about as well, and he's just excited. And thank you for all your lovely comments, dude. The Battlestar, he was enjoying the show, and he was asking some questions of us. When a figure is announced for sale, how many units are usually produced to make it profitable? So from what I know from years, and Matt may be different as well, because he's got a lot of toy connections and experience from the past, but from what I know, it will depend upon the figure to make it profitable. A good example was, I think it was Commander Fox, one that kind of floated around, and someone was, some numbers were mentioned in a few forums and topics were out there, that round about 10,000 units of a figure before, not necessarily that it was profitable, but that's potentially an average exclusive, maybe. It will depend upon the character, but that's my 2 cents on that. I can't see them making much less before it's profitable. What do you think?
Look, I think the number is somewhere between 8 to 10, and 8 is a reference to what was it, the San Diego Comic-Con Luke Skywalker X-Wing pilot.
Yep.
So that must be close to what the minimum number is. That's probably moved up to 10 now, and it's more along the lines of what's not profitable, but it's what they call, what is the MOQ, the minimum order quantity, to be able to justify the price in which they make it. So, you know, I think the minimum, the MOQ for the figures is 10,000, and then they skyrocket up above that for the more popular figures. There's no way they made 10,000 of the new Boba Fett's kind of thing. They would have made more, where they might make,
that's for sure. And look, getting into the price of it, without, we could be here all night talking about all the kind of individual components and parts, but we've talked about this many times before. One of the most expensive parts of the process is not necessarily the plastic. Paint is expensive because it's time, and it requires intensive either machinery or custom kind of work to be done. But the likeness and the licensing is a huge part of it too. So that all that factors into, you know, if it's like the dude with the broom from The Last Jedi, as opposed to, you know, Mark Hamill or whoever it may be, it will vary and all that. But I think 8 to 10,000, as we've kind of rounded it, is the kind of figure for that kind of stuff. And you're right, a lot of conventions I've seen the stock sitting there. I remember going to Star Wars Celebration, I literally seeing the stock sitting there, their entire stock for pretty much the show at that time. They didn't really sell much online. I think that's a pretty solid number, is the average amount. Give and take. The other question he had asked was, are the same number of figures always produced? Cassians and Jyns versus Rex and Empire Vader. I think that's a definite no. Vader, for example, is one of the top selling figures of all the characters out there. So Cassian, no. Not the same amount of figures. So that's my knowledge of it.
Unless they got them wrong, if you do remember, like, I mean,
sure.
The only reason why I'd say the question of Jyn and Cassian, and we're off the questions at the moment. We're back. The Jyn and Cassian ones, probably because of how long they stayed on pegs. But the other important thing was that was a really terrible stage of repacks. Mm-hmm. So you'd say Vader, who made his red line debut on one of the Force Fridays, outside of the 40th anniversary card figure, he was only in one wave.
Yep.
So he was in the 40th, and he was only in one wave after that. Jyn was in two or three waves. Cassian was definitely in two waves. So you could argue that they did make those decisions, whether whoever made the choice to how many to make or double pack. there was a lot of those ones, but I think generally speaking, the more popular figures will get more, and the less, you know, they also do the halfways, if you remember. So Baze Malbus and Charette. That was a half wave, which turned up, didn't go to all channels and disappeared quite quickly. It's like, oh, and they're discontinued for now. They came back in other areas, but it was like there have been those half waves. I can't remember what was another half wave, but there was definitely some half waves they used to do. I think it was the June wave was a half wave or something, and it was kind of in and out and no one really got it, and so there was definitely that was playing around with numbers
for sure. The last wave syndrome is a common thing that happened a lot in the 3.75 inch years, predominantly before the re-release of the vintage collection. It was just a continual thing that happened, and a lot of that tied around as well, I know for a fact, with Hasbro's end of financial years and what they did, and a certain amount of figures and stuff clogging the pegs and stuff sitting in warehouses and not allocated to financial gear is an issue for them. And that is a factor that, you know, us toy nerds don't really have to think about. But if they've got $1 million, $2 million, $5 million worth of figures sitting in a warehouse and it's not showing as sold on their financial stock for the year, then that's an issue for shareholders and other factors too. I mean, I'm just making these numbers up, but you get the point. They've got to shift that stuff. So sometimes they make decisions and that happens in this last wave syndrome, last wave of the tax year, where they cut it at a certain point because they just think half the production costs, if it's that bad, we'll do it again the next time. Or so there's a lot of logistics, I guess we could say, in terms of planning, timing, taxation, stock, shareholders, because Hasbro is a, you know, Hasbro is shareholders to keep happy. So they've got to not only keep the nerds happy like us, but juggle around the financial nerds too. The other nerds, exactly. The ones who make lots and lots of money. His other question, the Battlestar, was asking, who determines how many figures each seller gets? Who determines how many figures each seller gets? That's up to Hasbro sales managers and Hasbro sales reps. It's not necessarily a case of who determines how many figures each seller gets. Buy stores and direct accounts can decide how much they want to buy, but can you sell them all? So that one's a kind of if you want to sell 100,000 of Boba Fett, I guess you could put an order in. You may not get them, but you know, you may get a lot. So, which is another factor, what you order, you don't necessarily always get, hence cancellations or allocations. But that's my take on it. I don't know if you have any more there.
It comes down to in my experience at the moment, in a different field, but same field, it's like, what's available, who's the biggest, who gets priority and who gets left behind. And that comes down to essentially hierarchy of the retailer and hierarchy of the sales manager.
Exactly.
The higher the sales manager representing, the higher the retailer will get first preference and first access to available stock.
And just like normal human relations, because they are human, they have friends and like people they like more, and acquaintances in some stores and retails where they know them get some of the stock a little bit more often than others. And it's happened way too often for it not to be noticed. So yes, and certainly I'm sure if you're Amazon or Walmart, the Walton family snaps their fingers and says, we want this or we don't want this, and Hasbro have got to change. So hopefully that answers that one. And the final question you'd asked for, is it still a thing that an actor has to give permission for the likeness to be used? If so, how much do they get paid for? And Matt and I were just talking about this, and it's pretty much a flat fee, but you know a little more from your experience. So it's all wrapped up, isn't it?
Yeah, I think that what happens is these days, merchandise is part of the industry and all that other stuff, and it becomes so big. They don't necessarily get paid for every figure sold anymore. When you sign onto a role for Star Wars, you have to sign your likeness over at the time. If you don't sign your likeness over, you don't get the role. Mm-hmm. So it's that kind of side. You would assume that they're getting paid nicely enough for that role if they're a name. You want to bring Samuel L. Jackson into Star Wars, where, let's face it, he's got 8 scenes or something and some dialogue, but not a lot of dialogue. He's not turning up to set every day. He's not, you know, doing any of that stuff. He's signing his likeness over. That goes to Lucasfilm. Then Lucasfilm license out the property. They're not getting fees back for the items sold. They've been given the money up front, and then they get their residuals for TV sales and video sales or whatever it is, or syndication, all that kind of stuff. Every time it sells to another streamer, they'll get that kind of compensation, but they would not be getting individual license deals anymore. Because think about Samuel L. Jackson, or think about Hugo Weaving, or whatever it is, when you're in these massive franchises and all of a sudden you're going to get a royalty for something that goes beyond you now. And the fact that every figure, every character, every actor has a figure of them now, they're not giving royalties to all those individuals. They're just signing their likeness as a part of their sign-on fee, etc. Gone are the days of the Jack Nicholson Joker deals.
Yes, big money. So, it's interesting. I went to, it was a convention, I can't remember what it was, and Michael Biehn from Aliens, or Biehn, or whatever you want to call him, from Aliens Hex, was there, and he was incredibly candid and kind of slightly bitter about the movie industry and the way he'd been treated, and it would not been pleasant to him. And I think from memory, he'd said at the point that he literally only got something like 20 grand, £20,000 at the time, to do his part in Aliens. And that might sound like a lot of money to you guys watching the show, but as he explained, that was something like 4 months of his life on and off, and horrible sets and press and marketing and all sorts of stuff and training. There was a period of training that he had to go for as well. So it was a real chunk of his life. When you break that down to like 5 days a week, you know, it really was not a lot of money. Plus he had to pay tax on it. He has to pay money to agents and so forth and so on. So, and then amongst that, somewhere obviously with some agreement, it seems, for likenesses. So as you said, it's kind of signed away. So,
when it's not, then you've got the Tonkis sisters, whatever. You've got the issues with, for example, with NECA, which they've had, where they got finally got the likeness for April, and they finally got it for Casey Jones from Elias, and it wasn't there on the first one. It will be there on the next one, even though it was underneath the mask, but the mask was attached. Like for Casey Jones, it's like, it's in those instances where you can hold out and demand the money. Like I believe Carl Weathers, for example, was always a stickler for, you need to pay me for the Predator figures. They didn't back then sign the likeness for that one. But, you know, there's NECA had Apollo figures out. Star Wars obviously have had no issue with Grief Karga figures, but Predators, you know, big standoff over give me the money. And that's because the likeness wasn't in the agreement.
Yep.
Any of these big franchises now, all the likeness is in the agreement and there's no extra. And if we're talking about extra money, it wouldn't be gigantic.
Yeah,
kind of thing. It's just they're getting paid well enough for the movie and it's an all-encompassing deal.
Exactly. So there you go, the Battlestar. Hopefully that was answered some of your questions. And if you're watching and you want some of your questions answered, or at least a bit of a discussion on them, ask and we'll do a little x-ray into some of that stuff for you. Hope that was useful. Just going back to some of the questions and the comments that you guys kindly left for us. Hasbro needs to have a Republic Commando pack. Yes, I agree. I've actually got the original little 3.75 inch here somewhere today. I was playing around and I thought, why have we not got these yet? But I think given the backpacks, the blasters have been molded for the Bad Batch, I think it's safe to say 100% you will get the Delta Squad in the short future. They will not waste that sculpt in the mold. I'm sure that they're all different and they've all got slight tweaks, but ultimately, yeah, we've got the kind of casting, and it's a really good mold, those Bad Batch figures. A really solid sculpt. South P24, hello there. Really enjoyed the conversation on the 3.5 versus 6 inch. Yes, that was good. I'm sure people will say that as a biased view for a couple of guys talking something called the 6 inch show. But he's right. There is a bit of an attitude of entitlement. And there's always nutters everywhere. I mean, good God, I only mentioned politics, and there's some psychotic people right now in Arizona. That, you know, some crazy people out there doing crazy things. But, yeah, Ryan Johnson, Rosary, all the usual stuff that people complain about. But, yeah, we're here to collect, and we love toys. And and thank you, Kathleen Kennedy. I agree there, South B24. I'm fed up with these dumbass videos with like Kathleen Kennedy's ruining this. Oh, shut up.
Civil war is happening within the production team of Lucasfilm and Disney. John Favreau can do whatever he wants. He answers to Bob Chapek now.
It's the ones I've seen literal thumbnails and headlines and reasonable looking websites saying Kathleen Kennedy fired and Kathleen Kennedy, you know, something ridiculous. And it's like Fox News, but for shitty Star Wars. It's like, oh my God. Anyway, moving on. I'll start getting all political. So Force with Jesse is back twice. Okay. The War of the Die Hard 3.75 collectors, he agrees too. It's hilarious. Yeah, he's right. 3.75 was between 2007 and 2012. And we are definitely in a different era now. I agree. Good words, Jesse. Good words. Uffy K, I've seen him around as well. Yep, the argument about the scale of figures. Butthurt, B-U-T-T, hurt. Yeah, I can't believe some people haven't quite got over the butthurt of 6-inch and it's been around for nearly 6 years. It's like, my God. By the way, the Anakin 50th clone Star Wars head looks more like Cal Kestis or Tom Holland. Yeah, I think he's right, you know.
I don't, you know, there is definitely a big difference between the prototype shot and an in-hand figure.
True.
It's definitely come back more away. And we always find that with the prototype figures. But yes, the prototype wasn't to Anakin. It was kind of a realization of the animated version, only that we know what the real life looks like. So
yeah,
it's like, what are you matching to in this situation? However, it feels like the in-hand shots I've seen are a lot different to the prototype shot, whether they're more Hayden or not. Mm. They're not as far away as what the prototype shot was.
I think you've only got to look at the Bad Batch figures, watching it intently in the last couple of episodes, and how the figures are compared to the character art, and obviously it's a real life interpretation, as they say, and it really is. But it's still, yeah, it's you're right, Anakin's. We need to see it in hand. What else we got? Just a few more questions, and then we'll go into the new stuff. Christopher Miller, Jacob Cohen, I still don't understand how Marvel can do so much more than Star Wars for the same price. That's a question we need to probably tear into, and we'll maybe do that the next time. The Deluxe Thanos was an entirely new sculpt, shit ton of plastic, but it's not about the plastic. Plastic is cheap, well, currently, kind of going up, I think, really, as I'm sure.
Going up severely. Yep,
there you go. Give it an extra head, two extra hands, and retail for 30. Meanwhile, but remember, Jacob, that was one, plastic is not the most expensive thing. And two, it was a comic Thanos, not a movie MCU facial scan tech required Thanos. So rights are very, very cheap. Meanwhile, the gaming great Cal Kestis is also at 30, but basically just a reprint. That is a non-comic character facial scan. And we just talked about the cost of characters and facial skin. That's a whole different pile of costing that goes into it, where you don't have that with comics. And chip in if I'm, you know, saying anything wrong you disagree with.
I think also, well, at least in some respects, I don't know what the Hasbro deal is, but I would expect that the Star Wars license, traditionally, given its history with the brand and stuff, is more expensive than the Marvel license as well.
For sure. But yeah, definitely facial character and comic character, massive impact on costs. And plastic is just not... I mean, again, a lot of Marvel Legends figures are... there's a Deadpool there. relatively generic, but you know, it's just, it's red and there's very little sculpting and detail in many ways. It's, yes, there's some muscle tone, but there's no
there's color variations of costume. There's no browns with blues or oranges with grays. And look, it's the other thing we can talk about later, or we can just, I'll bring it into here. The idea that, again, I say it a bit, in my estimation, Hasbro for Star Wars uses about 80% original sculpts on all figures, yep, and 20% reuse. And I've always gone back to it. The Veers, Piet, and Tarkin all had unique sculpts for Imperial uniforms, kind of thing. There was not much, if any, reuse in, now you and I did it, we were looking at the vests and we were finding differences, the ranks, and then the sleeves were slightly different and the legs were slightly different. So there's very little reuse where it could be. And yes, the Jedi's do some reuse, but you're still talking about Kit Fister went for it to, I think it was the Obi-Wan body, and Plo Koon was the Mace body, or the other way around, whatever it was. But then there were still different bodies between Obi-Wan, Mace, Anakin. Mm-hmm. And so even within the Jedi's, there might be reuse where they recolor it and whatever else, but there's still variations. It's not all of them having the same. Marvel tend to go with all of them the same. Sure. And, you know, you can identify this is the so-and-so sculpt, this is the so-and-so sculpt, but there's a lot more detail in Star Wars figures, a lot more unique sculpts, a lot more detailed painting, even with, you know, the MCU figures, generally Captain America is all blue with a little bit of white and red, kind of thing, where it all varies with Star Wars, unless we're talking about a stormtrooper, but you know.
Exactly. Yeah, so it's not quite it's not quite as easy as you're saying there, Jacob, the cost factor. Why is one $30, the other one $30? It's not quite apples for apples, oranges. It's not quite that right comparison. So licensing and facial scan and sculpt and detail and yeah, all that factor makes a difference. Hopefully that answered that question for you. Interesting stuff. Please do leave a comment under the show if you've got any more questions. This is interesting. Love this stuff. Christopher Miller does not care about packaging at all. Let it be known. It's all about figure photography. Will you be interested then, I'm sure, Christopher, as you've been here for a while, Ziploc bags and tubs all day, baby. Love it. Yes, well, toy photography section coming right up. Imperial Tech was just saying on the 3.75 issues, I bet most of the crying is coming from Americans. That's a little bit countryistic. And there's 330 million of them compared to, say, 60 million in the UK. So, yes, they will be loudest because they tend to buy the most. Michael Keaton would destroy the Ben Affleck. I still think that. It's like, give me Keaton anytime. You guys are like Ben Affleck.
Okay. I'll just make this quick because it's not really about 6-inch things, but let's just put it out there. Are we saying which Batman is better? Because one is a fact. Ben Affleck's Batman would own 89 Batmans.
What does all mean?
Kick ass? Ben Affleck in one of the films, was it the, it must have been Batman vs. Superman.
That was stunning. That was stunning.
Cut to a mother.
I'm talking about
the fight sequence. Built and the fights and everything. But let's even, we're in the post-Jason Bourne era of much better fighting. But yes, he would own him in that sense. But just even the physical presence of Ben Affleck in Batman vs. Superman versus little Michael Keaton in 89 Batman, fresh out of Beetlejuice, and little man in rubber suit.
I think Ben Affleck, like a bit of a coat hanger. He's just a bit of a, he doesn't do anything. He's just kind of, Keaton's range is way bigger than Ben Affleck. No?
Come on.
Is that you doing Ben
Affleck? Well, I can't do Ben Affleck, but it's just like, look, I am an 89 fan. I loved Batman 89. I dig Michael Keaton as well, but it's just like, please. The brutal force of Ben Affleck in Batman vs. Superman is unlike Batman has ever been put on the
brain. It's a wonderful sequence where he kicks ass and punches through the roof.
I'll take that people can love Michael Keaton as Batman, but to say that Michael Keaton would own Affleck, please. Okay.
So, childish war here we're having. Your comments will make the difference, not what we feel. You'll just go, your people from your page to come over. But Michael Keaton or Ben Affleck, your favorite Batman, not ours, your favorite Batman, let us know in the comments below. We'd love to know. Michael Keaton. So what happened? So some Star Wars stuff happened and reveals were given on a Hasbro Pulse YouTube panel. And then the day after, at 1 p.m. Eastern, they gave you a chance to buy them. Well, kind of did, and then maybe. They flew out the door. Yeah, maybe. So a lot of 3.75 inch stuff. We're just showing you the 6 inch stuff here. Let's look at what was revealed, and they were kind of interesting. Now, before anybody complains at me saying they're reusing parts, that's not meant to be a bitchy thing. It's meant to just be a interesting thing, because it sometimes shows you where they're going to use the character again. But Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order gaming greats, Knight Brother Warrior from Matt's, one of his favorite games. How exciting. Were you kind of really quite into this, or were you like, meh?
I didn't see it coming, to be
honest. No, I didn't either. Like,
I didn't see it coming, so I was super happy and super impressed. To me, okay, let's get it out of the way. It's the Darth Maul apprentice body from a couple of days ago.
Yep.
It's a different head. It might be the same body. It might be Maul's legs or whatever. But damn, it's Dathomir or whatever you call them.
Dathomir.
Like, I mean, Dathomir, they're these mystical creatures who pretty much look all the same. Like, it's not like,
exactly.
You know, your savage oppress is different and stuff, but the rest of them, the Knight Brothers in the game, all look the same. And Apprentice Maul is essentially, obviously, either based on this, or this is based on Apprentice Maul as a, not a wild Dathomir, but, you know, an unrefined Sith Master kind of thing. So it's like, it makes sense to me. And when I look at this figure, I do not see, I see a different head. I see a different color. I see a different paint scheme of tattoos or whatever. I do not see the Darth Maul apprentice when I look at that figure. So to me, it's a unique figure, and that's how I look at it. And I really dig it.
And it will not be the only one you'll get, because there were several of them in the game differently colored.
There was red ones, and there was, yep, there you go. There was ones with bows and arrows. There was ones with staffs.
There we go. There's a few character models, green a red, eyes. A mustard. So you're getting this figure again. So get used to it. Gaming Greats is not shy about reusing it, and that's a plus and a minus in some ways for some people, and you can choose to buy it or not. But as Matt said, it's reusing the Maul apprentice body, the kind of comic pack version. And I tell you one thing I didn't realize until we were just looking there was the kind of acid like stains or whatever, I don't know what it is, like, from the game. I remember that the paint, I guess they obviously put on them, but it looks pretty good. It's just that tattoo transfer. Go ahead.
Complaining about a reuse of this figure is like complaining about the reuse of a stormtrooper.
Exactly.
It's a soldier. It's a soldier, and it is what it is. Like, you know, the main, let's be fair, the main thing people are complaining about is the reuse of the Maul legs again.
Yep.
And so, flip side, maybe Hasbro could have used the waist up of Darth Maul and the waist down, I'm not saying Kylo's pants, but maybe you could even use the Jedi pilot pants legs or whatever it is, which are slightly thinner in their figure, make them brown so it doesn't look like the orange. Like, I don't know, maybe that would be a variant, but still keeping the skirt thing hanging over. But to me, it's a new figure. I don't really, this isn't the stuff I worry about personally. I see a brand new head, and I see a brand new color. I see a brand new character.
Totally. I mean, there's guys there with bows and arrows. There's a female Dathomirian, I guess you could call her. So yeah, I think.
Oh no, she's a, what was she? She's a sister. She was a, yeah, a knight sister who had been slain, and there's only the one person left.
But there's just to say, you know, that there'll be a possessed knight brother. Now they're gonna milk this thing, quite rightly so, because it's a very, very popular character. There you go, knight brother Archer. Guaranteed you're getting him. Just an absolute guarantee, and they'd be nuts not to, because it's an absolute fan favorite.
But you know they're making use of the
exactly
figure. The only thing I take an objection to out of all this is when you are basically just for a new head recreating the previous release figure and reusing the mold, where it's now just become priced. It's not like this figure is more expensive than other figures, but GameStop has now, and EB and Zing, etc., have now basically made it a $25 figure simply because it's a gaming grade. Even though that line in itself, majority is a reuse kind of thing, but we're paying $5 more than the original sculpt figure. And that's been happening across the world. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're milking it, but they're milking it on the figure that actually costs less to make.
I know. Oh, totally. So it's complete exclusive. So, you know, and again,
which
don't buy it. And look, actually, I'm not buying it. There you go. So there's a shock.
But see, this would be the thing, and we'll I know we're getting to them in a sec, but if you look at Zing, for example, which is, for everyone else, our EB Games / GameStop here in Australia, the gaming greats are priced at $55 Aussie, yet the other two reveals, which are the Walmart ones, are $45.
Yeah.
There's a $10 difference between the two different exclusives from the same retailer, which means to me that Hasbro's also charging more for the gaming great line.
Correct. And I was just looking up the cost there, even that $55 Australian dollars is $43 US. I saw somebody complain like, oh, $25, it's like the sky's falling. And I'm like, you need to suck it up, princess. You have no idea.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's not super cheap. The figure is available to buy, and buy it.
Or so
buy it.
Available GameStop in the US, Toys R Us in Canada,
correct.
Star Action in the UK, Hasbro Pulse in the UK, Zavi in the UK, and available at Zing in Australia and New Zealand.
Yep, pretty solid figure, but yeah, you're getting a bow, and you're getting a red one. And it'll look probably really good. So there you go. And it looks fantastic. The packaging presentation looks great. The art looks great.
And just on that picture.
Yep.
Just go to the other picture, actually, the one on an angle, the next packaging shot.
Hold on a second. This one?
The angled one, yep. And close up.
Yep.
There is a Wookiee or something next to him.
Yes, that's right. Or a very hairy woman. I don't know. Yeah, that's a good point, actually. Could be like a kind of pimp coat thing that, you know, I don't know, one of the aliens wears, they wear a kind of fur thing or something, but yeah.
It's going to have to come from a game. It's going to have to come from a game. So
I think from that game, one of the characters had a kind of, didn't they? They had a kind of,
it could be Charpool the Wookiee.
Could be
The witch was wearing the hood. Yeah. She was in the hood in the black and red, so.
Yeah, Tarful was in the game, you're right. And he's not that different from Chewie.
Yeah.
Cool. The Knight Brother is a-coming. And the other one that was kind of interesting was this. With brand new Stormtrooper, Clone Trooper body, Pinless Tech. What did they call it again? Jointless Tech? We were talking about jointless something.
What do they call it? Yeah, they had a different name for it.
Even though they've referred to it as Pinless Tech, it's kind of Jointless Tech they were referring to internally, I think. But anyway, Shock Trooper, non-removable helmet with a pauldron. I'm sure you probably agree with me that this figure is 100% going to come out in, and there was no box picture. That's right.
There was no box picture, no.
That sucks. Maybe there's a reveal on the box. But the Shock Trooper, without a doubt, will come to the main line. I am very positive, minus the pauldron, I would suggest.
Yeah.
Even with a facial scan tech head and call it whatever, Captain. There was one of the clones had a... it was a Shock Trooper Captain. Terrible spelling there, but you get the point. What was his name? Damn it. Can't remember. No, not him, not Foxy. Oh, well, there was another one. There was a character that was around somewhere, and he would, Commander Gray, is this a movie? No, oh, well. There are Shock Trooper Captains, and somebody was... you can have a facial. So there's plenty of reuses there. And let's face it, it's a really solid clone body. It's updated. I am very glad to get this. The other Shock Troopers were big, big sellers way back in the day. Again, exclusive way back in the day as well, which really pissed everybody off. So yes. Which I think it re-released at one point, a Shock Trooper. I seem to remember
it. No, they talked about it getting re-released and it never came out.
Never came out. There you go. Well, it's out. Go and grab it. The other one here, sort of the disjointed kind of sequence, is a Flame Trooper from Jedi Fallen
Order. Jedi Order.
Fallen Order?
Fallen Order, yeah. Jedi Fallen Order, yeah, there you go.
Flame Trooper, given heavy Ralph McQuarrie concept trooper vibes with that helmet, which it was based upon, but I find it kind of funny that whilst it's using obviously parts of a snowtrooper, understandably, but you would wear the same snowtrooper gear as you would to be a flametrooper. there's no quite right about that. But nice blaster, looks really cool. I don't think there was a shot of the backpack that clearly. All we get was the side. So it's kind of new backpack, pretty much. But yeah, very, very Ralph McQuarrie inspired design anyway. And most
new arms, I think, the new elbows and articulation, I think.
Yeah.
But and the shoulder pads and stuff, I think they're talking about.
Nice. But it does look good. And again, it's a pricey one, isn't it, from memory?
Yeah, it's the 55 one, like the Knight Brother, because it's a inverted commas gaming grade.
Yeah, I mean, I guess you could argue that is that looks awesome on the packaging. Does look awesome. Damn it, now I want it. God damn it.
So who's the one next to them?
Well, that's a kind of an Imperial person, because it's a little Imperial. Well, it could actually be a Rebel.
Yeah.
It's Cal Kestis. There's the little droid.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
BB-1 or whatever his name is.
Yeah. So. BD-1, yeah.
I think that's the outfit with his cape.
That's the orange one. That'll be the orange one.
So, yeah, that'll be a nice little set. But Flame Trooper looks very cool, actually, there. Damn it. Just spent money. But, yeah, that's a nice little figure. And the other one, which I don't think anybody get too frothy about, was...
the Mouse Droid?
Well, yes.
Everyone liked the Mouse Droid.
A Mouse Droid came out as something else. Am I going mad?
It was in a 3-pack from Galaxy's Edge.
Thank you.
But it hasn't been in a figure yet.
Yep. So, looking like a Tarkin body, for the most part.
But it's not, because you got the new articulation.
That is correct.
So, again.
There you go. Okay.
More unique sculpts.
There you go. Colonel Rampart, I think it was.
Vice Admiral Rampart.
Admiral Rampart, there you go. From the Bad Batch. So we'll find out what he does and how evil and or how nice he is. Might invite the Bad Batch around for a cup of tea and scones and talk through things. You never know. But yeah, look,
it's going to come down to the show, really. Otherwise, it's just whatevs.
Go ahead.
We get this guy before we get a Callus.
Yeah.
From Rebels, you know.
I know. Well, you know, a lot of people would used to complain before they never got these kind of characters. So you get one. So buy it or buy it not. Hasbro will get the sales data and they will know, and they will make more or less. But nicely done in the facial scan. Looks quite realistic. Quite nicely sculpted hair, but not much else really going on with that character. There is the box, sorry, correct. Yes, Vice Admiral Rampart. Looks quite different from the pack, actually. But there we go. So no secrets on the side of the box there? No.
There's a figure on either side. So one is the, let's call one the...
looks like a jetpack.
Yeah.
A trooper's pauldron.
That's a pauldron. I can't remember what the other one was. The one with the pack on the back might be the flame trooper. Mm. Corner of the flame trooper or something. I'm not sure. But...
Well, that's the blue lane. Anyway. So that'll be...
Oh, so it won't be, yeah. So,
it's part of the Bad Batch colour.
Well, one of them will be the shock trooper.
Yeah, probably
that one.
Yeah, interesting. So it was a nice reveal. We've always revealed the Clone Wars before. The Clone Wars figures. Sorry, we should mention Rampy was he was exclusive. Walmart.
He was a Walmart with the Shock Trooper.
Yep.
Toys R Us in Canada against Star Action and Zavi and Hasbro Pulse in the UK and Europe kind of thing. And Zing EB again in Australia and New Zealand.
So from my count at the time from the press release, I think it was two vintage collection figures, non-exclusive. A third one, Tebow, not yet announced as what time week that'll be available to pre-order. And every single other figure that was revealed was an exclusive.
And there was one pipeline reveal of the girl from the last clone from
Omega.
Bad Batch. Omega, yeah.
But it was just a bit, oh, it's exclusive. Oh, it's exclusive. Oh, it's exclusive. Oh, it's exclusive. And that was just the 6-inch.
5 days after the Clone Wars exclusives.
Correct. And I think I was thinking about that the other night. I thought one of the reasons why I think they revealed those Clone Wars figures in advance was because if they dropped one, two, three,
eight four, figures.
Yeah, eight figures, every one of them exclusive, I think we would all have metaphorically crapped the bed.
Yeah.
So I think breaking it up was a kind of strategic PR move. But getting sick of those exclusives. And if you watch the Hasbro live streams every time the comments, stop the exclusives, stop the exclusives. But they're not going to stop the exclusives. So
they're not going to stop them. But again, look, we've probably spent too much time just talking tonight. But it's like... if you're going to make exclusives, there's two approaches you can take. Make so many of them that they don't sell out in 2 minutes. Correct. Or they don't sell out on shelves within the first day or hour that they're put out. Like, if they're that popular, you're obviously making the MOQs for what could be popular figures. And they're not lasting anywhere. No one's like, they're going, oh, thank God, the... Clone Trooper figures are all starting to turn up again 5 months later and there's another 10,000 of them in the market, or just make them exclusive for 3 months.
Correct.
Like they're doing with the Marvel Legend Retro figures, put them out to the fan channels and everything else, or just open up the market like NECA does and say, okay, Target has them for 3 months and whatever else, and then everyone else gets a shot. If you want to make money on something, sell and make as many of them as you can. If you want to get full value out of your sculpt, give Walmart the 10,000 units for them to sell in 10 seconds, or make the 10,000 for the world, break it up across the 3-4 territories you're doing it in, let Walmart have their big win of the day or whatever, and 3 months later give it to other people, and Walmart's making no less money by doing that. It's a win for everyone.
I agree, but I mean, you'll just never take the rectal warps like this out of the world. It just, you know, $70, more than 10 available. You know, Can't even spell it properly. This is a pre-order Junio 2021. You can't even get some decent photographs for $70. That's just ridiculous. There's not a lot of them on there, but you always get your chances. Yeah, it's the same. The toy squad. You're scum. You're not just appalling. So, and then people are buying them at $70 a pop. It's probably cheap for an exclusive like this, actually. So, god damn, it's just soul destroying and pees all over the Hasbro brand, I think, the way they do this. But it's not as if we haven't complained about it. Anyway, moving on. I think that covers us for Star Wars. Very quickly, G.I. Joe.
Focus at the moment.
What's that?
You're out of focus.
I'm out of focus. Am I?
Yeah.
I'm very in focus, actually. Well, I think it's a little bit of a delay.
There you are. Okay.
Okay. I think there's a little bit of a lag just because we're recording this. G.I. Joe, Commander Blood? No, Major Blood. What am I talking about? Major Blood was finally officially revealed. I very fortunately managed to get one, and he's a wonderfully good figure. Really, really good. So definitely try and get one. You pick it up. Apparently it's supposed to be May the 19th is the US release day in Target. There's a very good chance that it might be available at some other places. Robot Kingdom, maybe Azavi, I doubt it. But certainly in maybe Hasbro Pulse in the UK, they potentially may get it. But blink and you'll miss it. They'll sell it and they'll go straight on eBay because, you know, that's what scalpers do. So that's what's going to happen. But they've at least acknowledged it. So there we go. G.I. Joe, didn't realize I wasn't following. That is that for G.I. Joe. What else do we have? We had some Marvel Legends stuff. Let me just head up here, it'll be a whole lot easier. So since we were off air, we're not on air, but you know what I mean, since we were last off air, whatever.
On the tubes.
There was some reveals, and some of the figures that were revealed were Disney Plus, with the Falcon and Winter Soldier. We've was fully available and revealed, and I think we pretty much covered, or we expected most of these. John Walker, repaint of the Walmart exclusive. Quite a nice figure, really. Not super exciting, but gun glued in to the holster. Shocking, but there you go. And as you can see on the back of these images here, you build up and get Falcon, which some people were not happy about. You've got to get all these other parts to get the wings, but you're getting a stand and you're getting a lot of stuff involved. So it's
not the first time they've done it either.
Correct.
They did it with the Vulture from Far From Home, or no, Homecoming,
yeah,
or whatever it was.
Yeah, it was the Vulture. That's right. Big stand in it as well.
Just the thing that annoys me about this, and I'm all for, you know, we're going off prototypes and all that other stuff, but that US agent, to get the whites where the reds are, the black where the red is, and yep, whatever, it's just it's frustrating, and I get it, but that's a kind of more basic one. To me, it's not, oh, we didn't have a look at what the Avengers outfit was and it changed. It's like, US agent has white and red, and yeah, that is literally just a repaint of the first outfit. So yes, it was, if you're gonna do it and use it and have the inaccurate A on the head and everything else, just get the white and red ready, and I would have been like, that's still awesome. But it's a little frustrating, and I'm not the person who usually gets upset by those things. But it's like, I want my US agent to have white.
Yes.
I want the flag there, kind of thing.
Exactly, because the US agent, for those that don't know what we're talking about, this is good, yeah.
Well, even if you look at the art that they put on the back of the box, which is where, yeah, I kind of reference the inaccuracy.
Yeah, and there's no E on the helmet. There's no and there's white, as you mentioned. But yeah, they've kind of there's the classic US agent. I remember that one. So yeah, that was one reveal with all this Disney Plus stuff. So we had a bunch of other figures in the wave. I think we pretty much, I mean, Baron Zemo we'd seen before. Scarlet Witch we'd seen before. She's looking grand.
Where Bucky, are the clone trooper? Is that just me?
I think you're a little bit lagged.
On the clone trooper. I'm going to keep quiet now, but here, now we're on US agent. There we go.
Yeah, I'm seeing privately in the back here. I can see you're freezing a lot, but it's like I can hear the audio coming through.
Cool.
So Bucky's looking good, not too shabby. A little bit mega blue on the paint, I thought, but still cool nonetheless. Nicotine vision. I don't know how this is out. How can that out with that yellowy stuff? But there we go. That's my thoughts. There's Bucky Barnes there. It's definitely like a much darker blue. But anyway, we also get a Loki, which is a kind of sneak peek reveal Loki from the soon to be awesome looking show. Don't know what's going on with that.
Which got brought forward, by the way, for anyone who's interested. Right. It was meant to be September, October. It's now going to be Wednesdays, June 6, I think.
Mm.
From June 6.
Wednesdays are the new Loki days, yes. He did a little promo video. It was very funny. It's pretty good. Another trailer in there too. Yeah, kind of weird figure, but okay. You know, reusing the old suit from... so many figures. I've even got one right here that everywhere. Marvel Legends just love that suit. It's like the Nick Fury jacket. So those figures came out. We also had, what else we have? Quicksilver. I should have mentioned him. New pre-orders, I think. So they posted there. Quicksilver amongst all. Oh, wow. Tons of stuff. Those new Super 7 Disney figures. Where the hell's Quicksilver? Let's look. So yeah, there we go. The Age of Ultron figure with new price from Hasbro on it. Prices are going up. But you got some extra nice little bits there, I thought, with the figure. Not only do we get a proper Quicksilver, swap out hands as it should be, with these little trademark fingers. You didn't see this coming. But a little bit of Ultron parts and pieces, which I thought was really cool, which kind of hints at a potential to have some Ultron drones, I don't know, to build up a little army for you. And maybe a proper Ultron that's all damaged from the sequence movie. I don't think we ever got one. No, we did not. Got a hot toy of it, but we never got a damaged Ultron. So that's pretty much it for Marvel Legends, I thought. Apart from, as you've said, and you've got it on your channel, we can have a look at in just a sec. Where are we? Six Sense Legends. So on the stream, they revealed a shirtless Wolverine. Or Logan. Coming in 2021, yeah, he talked about body hair intensely, Dwight. I wonder where he was going, but it was every figure they revealed, he was talking about hair. Why is this one here, and hair there? It's kind of funny. They do a good show, those three. I like them when they're all together. Are you still with me, or are you frozen?
No, I'm still with you. I can still hear you, but I can't see too much, so I'm just going off what you're saying rather than what I'm seeing.
Maybe even freeze your video if you want for a little while, if you can. Maybe that's you can stop your video.
That's right. Go with it. I can work it out.
So the other figure that was revealed was a kind of digital render of Johnny Storm prior to Flame On, looking very good indeed, with a little flame effect, and noticeably pins there, actual visible kind of pins on the wrist, which is kind of new. For that joint, but anyway, that'll be interesting. What else do we have? And Hercules, another hairy figure. another Hercules. So yes, a Greek Hercules, really more comic based version of him. What else did we have? Mezco released Bishop from the X-Men, which was pretty stunning looking, has to be said. A lot of people really like this figure. 6-inch scale, just over 6 inches, 6.4 inches. A couple of swap out heads, lots of weapons, but looking pretty good if you're into the Mezco. I kind of was for a while, but there we go. But that's looking pretty nice indeed. Lots of soft fabric and very detailed, lots and lots and lots and lots of accessories. I mean, it's just the list. It's a mini hot toy. So there you go. That was that. And the other one was Mythic Legions, which I just mentioned there, or brought up this page. We don't talk about these very often, but these are kind of custom built figures by the I thought it was the Four Horsemen, isn't it? But it's the Store Horsemen.
Four Horsemen.
Yeah.
No, they're Four Horsemen. Their shop is the Store Horsemen.
The Store Horsemen. That would make sense. These look pretty incredible, has to be said, that they're really, really, really nice, some of these. If you're making...
They're insane. They're insane. Like, I mean, these are... It's the dumbfounding thing. What are they? These ones, I think, these are the what are they calling them? The Legion Builders or whatever. I think they're $25 a figure. And you put the paint and the minimum runs. We're talking about figures in the...
25 each.
Not in the... Yeah, these are 25, and I'll tell you the best painted figures out there. They're adaptable. They're solid. They're weighty. They're heavy. There's nothing but quality about them, and the fact that they can do them at $25, it's insane.
But then there's no licensing, and there's no
license. Like, I know, but just the quality for dollar. And they've built it up. They've built their own world, and they keep growing. And these figures, you want to talk not about scalping, because it's not so much scalping, but second market prices. Like, I mean, these figures, if you want them, you can buy them. No one who doesn't want them will miss out on them on release. They're made to order kind of thing. So there's not that world of scalping in this.
Yep.
But we're talking about when these figures go out of print, out of run, we're not talking about going up to $70. They get up to $200, $300, $400,
$500. Makes sense.
Kind of thing.
Wow.
It's insane.
That is nuts. Yeah, paint looks outstandingly good.
And anyone who wants to see some great photography of Mythic Legions pieces can simply go to the Instagram page, Mythic Legions.
There you go.
Another Toy Tribe page.
Exactly. Just, yeah, incredible looking details. And oh my God, that thing is nuts. That's absolutely crazy with the goat's head and stuff. It's God of War all the way. That's really nice as well. A real orc for your Lord of the Rings style stuff. Very, very nice. Oh, wow, look at that thing. That's insane. Chasing the Argonauts with the armor. So yes, Mythic Legions or storehorseman.com is where you want to go. Store-horseman Shopify, but just, yeah. We'll put a link in the show notes where you can go and find it more, but it looks pretty damn cool. So that is, I think, most of the... Yep, covered all of it. Hey, let's get to the juicy bit. The exciting, jammy, squishy, gooey bit in the middle is... or at the end in this case, is Matt's plethora of channels out there under the Toy Tribe kind of banner, but the two that we focused really on here is Star Wars The Black Series, Instagram.com/StarWarsTheBlackSeries and Instagram.com/6inchlegends. Let's get a look at his page and all the cool toy photographers out there and what is going on, and then we'll share them on screen. You can go and follow them and like them and see all the best stuff. Alrighty, let's go look what's going on. I'll blow this up a little bit so we can really see some of these photographs. I am just, it has to be said, I am loving my Dooku. I finally got room to put him on a shelf, and he's just such a good figure. Such a good figure, that Dooku. I'm sure that's going to be one gets a re-release in the future. There's Maul. A lot of people are getting him in hand. There's the same feet and et cetera, but still looks good.
So this is slightly slightly customized. Kimonian Customs is usually a big criticizer of Hasbro's inaccuracies and everything else and the reuses and everything else. But this is a figure, if you go to his original post, where he's very much high praise of it. The only changes he really had to do was paint the hands, because the hands come as a complete red, which is bizarre given that the Knight Brother has painted hands. So it's not like it was, it's just a bizarre scenario that the original Maul comes with the unpainted hands, but the Knight Brother comes with tattooed hands. So it's a bizarre thing. He also fixed up he customized the joints to the legs.
Oh my God. Really? That's the way it ships? With no paint on the hands?
Yeah, with no paint on the hands.
That's a bit of a cock up. God damn, I suppose it's an easy enough fix, but you shouldn't have to fix the figures, especially when it's an expensive
higher price. Yeah, exactly.
So what did he do there?
He did a little bit of a touch up here somewhere, but nothing major. It was the dot on the head. See the tattoo at the center? Yeah, see how it's a bit squarish and off, and then it's a more of an accurate dot.
What are we talking about?
The center of the forehead. He's fixed up the stripe from the middle horn. No. Yeah, that, and then go to the middle of the head. Right. Go up. And then
okay.
See, and so it's just a little touching up, but, he's usually quite critical of the mistakes. And if you read, he's kind of full of praise for this figure, not expecting to like it as much as he does.
Mm. Oh my God, he went to town. Holy balls. Interesting. Very interesting. I like it. Lots of lightsabers, lots of Jedi, little theme going on. All of the figures we talked about, Shock Trooper, Mr. Ramp. This was interesting. This is really nice. The original artwork you had here with the Yellow Fly Agency who've and piecing all this together just looks fabulous. Such nice artwork. Very, very nice indeed. Do like that. Yeah, I just can't find a way to display these damn things, man. I'm just they look so good there as a kind of like a hard box. I don't know. I think the square thing would have been, I think it would have improved it, but deluxe and everything just throws everything out. But nice looking images on the side of the box for sure. Do like that. And the same for this one here, the Return of the Jedi, beautiful little wave. Looking good with all the core characters. And again, deluxe box kind of buggers it up a bit, but hey-ho. So, love this one. Wow, that rendition of the original, kind of one of the original posters. That's phenomenal.
So that's all in camera?
Wow.
That's been captured all in camera. And, I don't usually post stuff that's not all Black Series and all that stuff. But, Luke is Luke's head is Black Series, and that's Han Solo's body. So I'll go with it's just too good not to share that one on May 4th.
Wow. My God, the effort and work involved. Where do people get the time? Oh, my goodness.
Trevor's a genius.
Wow. Oh my goodness. God, I'm addicted to watching this now. This is why we need stands. Nice. And all the distance just makes all the work. Love it. My God. Well, you can go and watch the full thing. I'm going to show the full thing away. But yeah, just wow. That's a lot of work for one photograph. Damn. Bit of Greedo from the Amazon exclusive. line there. Bad Batch, there's going to be a lot more of them coming up soon. Just I love them. Really solid, chunky figures. Nice. Are you okay? Was that, are you okay, D?
Well, are you okay? Just went out with things. So it was, it's not quite the day, but it was just on May 4th. You know, it's a good time to have the conversation anyway. And, you know,
yep.
Regardless of anything else, it's a good message on a day focused on Star Wars and, you know, a community kind of thing.
Your Remus Stormtrooper, a little Hasbro kit. That's an incredibly nice touch-up on the look. Do you know what they've done
yet? Isn't it?
What have they done?
I guess it's been repainted.
God, it's just so sharp and focused there. Damn. A bit of, what was it, Cobb Van? There you go. Looks great, actually.
That's using the new Boba Fett body.
Oh, nice. Okay. Guaranteed we will get one of them. Loving the Return of the Jedi Boba Fett. I've had a few people in here, and the everybody, Star Wars fans, and no one were like, oh my God, that Boba's stunning. So he looks, yeah, particularly good, especially with these flame on. So great looking figure. Yeah, the Gaming Grace, we both got them. What do you think? I actually kind of like the two of them now that they've got slight differences in the pauldron. It's kind of a nice little set.
Yeah, I think it's a good little set. Mm-hmm. I remember when I first got the original one, I'm like, but the one in Battlefront's all white. And now I've got the one which is all white. I'm kind of like, I still like the yellow one.
Exactly. The Solo Mud Trooper, that was always a great figure. Really, really liked that one. And Han Solo Mud Trooper, or whatever you, Mimban Trooper, I think we called it.
Yeah.
Ahsoka, yeah, like it. The troopers, lots of Bobas. And some Darth here for Gregory Titus. Okay. An older one.
That was from the Hyper Real one. It was a Hyper Real one, but he'd shared the art and it was just like, hey, let's get back to some Gregory Titus art.
And I was mentioned in here because, yep, you know, I didn't like it. I thought I did. Scatter Squad. Love it. Love it, love it, love it. That's a nice detail. Looking really good. As is this one by South P24, who was just commenting on our vid earlier on. Stunning. Really, really good. Great looking pose and a little bit of photoshopping and looking awesome. And a behind the scenes too. I get all that work. Just hats off to all these people that take so much time to do toy photography. It's just,
and also share the secrets.
And share the
best thing about the community is no one keeps their secret. Well, you know, they share it, and it's for the benefit of everyone. It's there for people to learn from, and you know. It just shows you what you can do and shows you how to do it. And
there's a nice little throwing custom of the Veers helmet for that one scene. I think that Thrawn has a helmet and a waistcoat, I should say. Yeah, we probably won't get a Thrawn with that in a hurry, so not a bad one to do if you want to customize it. And really nice picture there of Bo-Katan. I think everybody's getting a chance to get one. She's selling very fast, but I think because of the double pack, it's really, really helped a lot of people. And back to a couple of really sexy dudes on some podcast thing they do. Damn, they're just smoking. Instagram.com/StarWarsTheBlackSeries is the cool page where all the really cool toy photographers have all their stuff. So check it out. And the other one we want to take a look at is one of Matt's other pages, Six Sense Legends. We just looked at some pics on there, but just again, to highlight it, Instagram.com/Six Inch Legends. There is your Kang the Conqueror. I do like him. He's growing on me every time I see him. Looking good by These Damn Toys. Nice Kirby color, bright looking image. People are loving those hand ninjas from the Stiltman Wave. I've seen so many people desperate to buy them for a little Red Ninja Armies. Not a favorite, but still good. Still good. The older Falcon, love that Wolverine. Really, really good. Slice and Dice by Crunchy Cheeto Creations. What a cool name. He's killing all the AIM soldiers. I like the blood, the plastic blood there. That's a nice effect.
Yeah.
That's really nice. Well done. Well done. Mr. Crunchy, good job. Or Mrs. Crunchy, I don't know what the male or female. There's the wrinkly old Vulture I used to kind of tell you I hated. Yep. do you remember Family Guy? And there was a weird old guy who was slightly pervy to one of the kids. That's what he looks like. so that's why I don't like that head sculpt. Box art for the figures. Well, funnily enough, that box art is way more goldish there, but yeah, it wasn't like that in the show. Anyway, Moon Knight looking good. Civil Warrior, very cool little figure. Did like the paint on that, and that's just a cracking looking photograph there by These Damn Toys. Very nice indeed. Lots of color splicing and put it all together. Makes very nice, bloody, but cool looking action pose. 33,000 people are following this page along with MODOK and the AIM soldiers. Check it out. Instagram.com/6inchlegends. Did you get your any of these? Did you get this Iron Man?
I got the Iron Man's on its way and the Civil Warrior. And then I didn't do the others, I don't think. Or maybe I did Stealth.
Really good Iron Man again. I know it's a repack, but it's just such a good figure. Such a good figure.
I'm all on board.
Yeah.
And, you know, call me crazy. I'll probably get a second one and customize it to have a yellow circle there.
Classic Iron Man, indeed, by Argor76 is there. Civil Warrior, again, looking a very cool figure. And some pack shots. Classic Hulk. Classic Wolvie, both looking fabulous. And then we're back to some of the figures that we covered. And Shang-Chi, which I think we covered in previous shows anyway. That's a rather ridiculously chesty Mary Jane Watson. That's a...
Yeah, it's a custom, obviously, but it's so Todd McFarlane.
Or did he make her very... huge chest.
He made her very chesty. She was a supermodel and all that stuff when
that's ridiculous.
Todd McFarlane was doing it. It's kind of accurate to Todd.
Yeah, it's just, it reminds me of a time
lots of lingerie pictures and all that stuff. It was Mary Jane in lingerie and all that kind of weird stuff.
Yeah. A little bit too kinky. And Red Hulk, we've covered some of these before. Oh, Punisher, such a good figure. Instagram.com/StarWarsTheBlackSeries and /6inchlegends or /toytribe is where you will find all of these really cool toy photographers and Matt picking out the best and making them look absolutely lovely. Anything else we didn't cover, want to cover, want to see, want to shout out? I can't think of anything else.
I don't think so. The only thing I'd say is remind everyone that between now and May 30th, you can pre-order your clone set heads from Old Boy Customs, Old Boy TTS, which we covered in the last show. That pre-order's open until the 30th of May. And yeah, I don't think we've covered everything else.
Cool. 80 is what we will be on the next show. We will see you for episode 80. Leave a note of your comments below. Again, questions you want us to ask. Anything would be great. Give it likey, subscribe, all that stuff, and visit Matt's pages. That would be really cool of you. We will see you for number 80. See ya.
Bye.